to the Dr. Jamie Show. I am so happy that you are here to join us today, VidChat and Facebook. Happy Friday, Cinco de Mayo. Yes, I have the hat for those of you that did not get to see it in the pre-show. I'm going to wear it the whole time so that the guest, Damian McKinney, family law attorney, right there, the McKinneyLawGroup.com, can laugh at me the entire time. But little does he know, he will slam back 6 shots prior to telling us about family law. Details are going to get juicy if we give him 6 shots before the Dr. Jamie Show. No, we didn't. They are empty. I'm just kidding. But isn't this pretty cool? I thought that was cool. I got it from Tommy Bahama a while ago. It was something that I wanted. One of those cheap splurges. You're like, am I really going to spend that much money on it? Yes, I am. One time, one thing. Blow your money. Have fun occasionally. Not all the time. The finance people are falling off right now. But yes, I did. I love that. I thought it was so cool. And then Tracy Rieger, if you go on Facebook, you can follow her. She makes these awesome candles. Look at these. Aren't they cool? They look like you can drink or eat them, but if you can see a close-up of this, she does a great job. She told me one time that she makes these like little pie candles. And that she kind of puts them in like different consignment shops and people buy them. And she'll go back if they're not purchased, pick them up and take them with her, you know, and resell them somewhere else. And she's gone there and people have bitten the pie thinking it was real. So she gets it back and there are teeth marks in it or there are pecans off the top that are gone because people ate them. Funny, but she does a great job. It tells you how great of a job. They smell good, they look good. This one even looks like it has salt around the rim. Very cool. Can't drink it. Not going to eat it live on the show. But for those of you just joining, welcome to the Dr. Jamie Show. We have an awesome show ahead of us. We have Damian McKinney with the McKinney Law Group. You can follow him at themckinneylawgroup.com. We are going to hear so much information today about family law, but he's going to make it fun. You know, I don't bring on those people that are like blah, blah, blah. We are going to hear some fun, juicy stuff about family law. We're going to get co-parenting tips. We are going to learn about different questions that we think that we don't say, some about adultery, and does it hold up in court? I might even ask him, and he doesn't know this yet, but like everyone says Florida has like crazy weird laws and we're like the weirdest state for that. I love you, Florida. I love Florida, but we've got some really weird stuff, so maybe he could give us some like weird law, like, I don't know, but we have weird laws here. There's got to be something he could pull. Make it up, we wouldn't know anyway. And then what about custody of your dog? We're going to find out who gets custody of your dog and if it's true for dogs, is it true for cats? No, I'm just kidding, but we are going to find out about dogs. So we have a great fun show ahead of us. Okay, so who is going to be on the show next week? We have Akesh Patel. He is the founder of Elevate. This man is everywhere. He does everything. His bio is so long, I can't even read it to you. So he's just going to have to share information with us about what he does. But what I love about this man is that he is so involved in the community. And it's elevated him, hence Elevate. He's the founder of Elevate. But why is it important that we get in our involved in our communities? And how can we strategically do it to not be overwhelmed? So he's going to give us some insider information on that. Then we have on the 19th, the power team, we have Lauren Davenport and Katie, and I got it, Kremitzos. That's right. She is the founder of Business Women Rock. Lauren is with the Symphony Agency. And we are going to sit here and we are just going to chat and have fun and answer your questions about business and family and I don't know what we're going to talk about. Just fun, fun stuff. We're going to have a power team session. Then on the 26th, we have Amanda Nelson on the show. She is the author of The Patched Wangs, W-A-N-G-S. I can't wait to read this book. I'm waiting for my copy to come in. She is going to tell us a little bit about her journey. She is recovering from using, and I believe she even said meth, and that is such a hardcore drug, and I want us on the Dr. Jamie Show to learn that when we go through something so hardcore and so tragic like addiction, and there's other things that we can perceive as being hardcore in life and very hurtful, how can it never be too late? How can we let go of that addiction, whatever it is, and move forward? And she's going to tell us, not only is she an amazing author now, but she's going to Penn State. Her entire life has changed. How did she do it? How did she drum that up inside, whatever it was, to overcome? We are going to find out, and that is on the 26th of May. Then we roll into the night. Yes, we have John McBride. He is the astronaut, and we will be live from the Kennedy Space Center. That is going to be such a fun episode. And I have here, he was the lead chase pilot for the maiden voyage of Columbia. He was also the pilot of the STS-41G. Yes, you see me reading the notes. That's too much. This man has done so much amazing stuff for NASA. And we're going to find out all about it on the 9th. Okay, and then do I have any more shows? Looking. No, but we have a ton of additional shows in June coming up. We have a nutritionist coming on. I'm reading my notes over here. We have the president and publisher at American City Business Journals. Then we have a segment, and I'm so excited about it, Flipping Houses. So many of you have requested it. Finally found someone amazing and expert in the field. And we are going to learn about what flipping houses is really like. So when I think flipping houses, I think skinny jeans with my nice coat, heels, one hammer, I hit the wall, and then I sell it for the house for $100,000 more than I just bought it 2 days ago. Thank you, HGTV. But I can guarantee you that's not what it's like, and we're gonna learn all about how flipping houses really goes, how you can be successful at it, and also there's gonna be some information in there for first-time home buyers. So that's going to be a really great show. So that's the lineup of guests. So much I know. Okay, so the rundown of different things. So those of you that are just joining, I'm sure that you want to hear the memes that I had for Cinco de Mayo. Cinco de Mayo, just so you know, is the Mexican Army's unlikely victory against French forces. But here in America, we celebrate it as like Mexican Americans celebrating them, celebrating their life, celebrating them being here. That is what Cinco de Mayo is in Mexico and over here in the U.S. But I have some memes for you that I want to share before I get to my admin, and keep me on track. I know I gotta stay on track. But these are so funny. So for those of you that are just joining, this is what I said in the pre-show, the Dos Equis guy, here we go. I don't always carry all the groceries in one arm, but when I do, my keys are in the wrong pocket. Ha, ha, ha. I know some of you laughed. I'll be reading these all weekend, just so you know, and I'll read them with my hat on. Okay, all right, the next one, I've got four of them for you. Number two, I don't always show friends YouTube videos, but when I do, they don't load. Ha, ha, ha. Right. All right. I don't always lose my phone, but when I do, it's on silent. Ha, ha, ha. Okay. And then the last one, and I know you'll get it. I don't always keep people in suspense, but when I do, that's right. I was keeping you in suspense. Ha, ha. Okay. I know you're laughing. So with that being said, we're going to roll right into the last of the admin here. And then we will bring on Damian McKinney, family law attorney, to answer all your family law questions today. So I always like to share some tips with you. I have six tips here, but I'm only going to share three of them. If you want to read the rest of them, go to Maria Shriver's website. Type in Jamie Kulaga and Effective Parenting. You could even go to Google, Jamie Kulaga and Effective Parenting, and I will share with you six tips on how to better parent in this busy, busy world. So here are the three that I'm going to share with you from the article. So effective parenting is important for many reasons. Of course, we want to have happy children and build strong relationships, but at the same time, we can be very stressed as parents. So I'm going to give you some of these tips here. Tip number one, be present with your child. So often when we are with our children, we are doing many other things. From laundry and cleaning to social media and work, we are giving our children quantity time, but forget about the quality time that is much needed. Here's the fix, parents. Give dedicated, present, quality time with your child. Even if the time frame isn't long in duration, the fact that they are your whole world for 20 minutes means so much more than 2 hours of time where you fail to acknowledge them very much. Think quality versus quantity when it comes to spending time with your children. Tip number two, provide an environment of love and forgiveness. I want you to listen to this one. In a rush world, some of us are guilty of creating an environment of fear instead of love and forgiveness. By instilling fear, it appears on the surface that if the child knows not to do something, they better not, or else. So the hope is they just won't act out. But children will make mistakes. It is their job to try new things and not always be right and successful. Here's the fix. Allow children to make mistakes. Give them the security to try new things. This will open their mind to new experiences, which will matter later on in life. And even when they make a big mistake where consequences are deserved, be sure they know you still love them and you forgive them. And the final tip that I'm going to share with you is don't make it all about you. That's hard to do, parents, especially when you've been through it before. So here we go. As parents, in many situations our children face, we have been there before. So it makes sense from our point of view that when we talk, we chime in with, I know how you feel. I went through that before, and here's how you will need to handle this. The truth is, they don't always care about how you handle the situation. This is their first time they are going through an issue, and it is major for them. Here's the fix. Listen, listen, finally listen. After you listen, ask if they want you to help them come up with solutions. If they do, start asking questions to guide them to come up with their own answers, especially with adolescents. They like being right and coming up with answers of their own. Acknowledge how tough this must be for them. If they want to know if you went through something, share the experience if appropriate. But take this time to take interest in what they're going through. It is their first love. It's the end of the world. They love him so much. It's been a full 2.5 weeks they've been dating. It's love. But you've got to allow them to make mistakes. You know I love doing this, so I'm going to do this. Okay, done. I just love doing that. Okay, so moving on to the final advent of the show before we bring out much anticipated the Damian McKinney with the McKinney Law Group. Okay, here is the rundown of things you need to do. Follow me. Go to youtube.com, type in Jamie Kulaga, K-U-L-A-G-A. Click that follow button, that subscribe button for me real quick. Book, grab a copy of the book. So, The Superwoman's Guide to Super Fulfillment is a great Mother's Day gift. Sister, moms, daughters, girlfriends, wives. Hopefully not girlfriends and wives. I'm just kidding. Ha ha ha. Ha ha ha. Okay, I'm just The Superwoman's Guide to Super Fulfillment. Go to Amazon.com, grab a copy of this book if you would, and support me. I appreciate all your support. Every single like, every single follow means a lot to me, truly does. Okay, so I thought I would share with you something that we shared with our Tampa family. So many of you know I own Two Maids and a Mop. It's a residential cleaning company in Tampa, Florida. And we are offering a $5,000 referral fee. No catches. You heard right. $5,000. So I am the area developer for North Carolina, D.C., and Florida. If you are looking to purchase a franchise, or you know someone that is, if they purchase a franchise because you referred them, we are going to give you $5,000 as long as it's in qualifying territory. You can call 813-390-9900. If you want a cleaning in Tampa, or if you are looking to purchase a franchise in one of those territories. And again, if you refer someone and they purchase a franchise, you will get the $5,000. All right, moving on. So the book, For Teens by Teens. So for those of you that are just joining that aren't familiar, we are starting an ebook under the Dr. Jamie brand and Pure 99 Publishing. It will be 99 cents for this book. Super cheap because we want teen girls to have access to it. It is a book for teen girls by teen girls. So if you know a teen girl ages between the ages of 13 and 19 that would like to be published in a book, it will only be their first name and their age. Location and last name will not be in there, nor will any identifying information in their synopsis. We want them to write about an experience that they went through, what they learned from it, and if they were to mentor someone a little younger from them, how would they mentor them? Giving these girls a leadership role to becoming role models, and then also educating girls. And this is going to be on topics like social media, bullying, what to do if your dad or mom aren't around, how to handle boys, saying no and still being cool, how to be popular, and just so many different areas that girls face we're going to talk about in the book. The Mommy Mastermind is officially up and running. So in 2018, right now we are booking for the 2018 sessions. It is going to be a group of 15 women or less that come together, and they talk about business, and they talk about family, how to run these things, the hiccups that they're having. We're going to have keynote speakers. It's going to be an amazing time. Go to drjamiekay.com, click on the Mommy Mastermind tab to find out more information about that. You are done hearing me ramble. You want to hear the master of disaster. No, I'm just kidding. It just rhymed. Okay, so in the back here, we are going to bring out right now Damian McKinney, family law attorney. Come on down. Yay! I need music
and clapping.
Hello.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, thanks for coming. So do we get to see you in the hat for like just at least 5 seconds?
Absolutely. Happy Cinco de Mayo.
I know, happy Cinco de Mayo. Yay!
And let's...
Oh, we're getting pictures taken. Yep, we're famous. Okay, so thank you for being here. Okay. So the first thing that we do when we have a guest on the show is we have them tell the viewers something unique or interesting about themselves that nobody or very few people know. So can you share with the viewers something unique about you?
Sure. As you know, family law attorney, I divorce people every day. However, not many people
Great
know.
Great tagline. Great tagline.
However, I am also an ordained minister and I perform weddings.
Oh, I love it.
One-stop shop, right?
Yes, I So that's great. So if you want to get married, you come to him. 4 weeks later, if you want divorced, you go after on him. So good to know. One-stop shop. I love that. One-stop shop for all your marriage needs right here. See, that's how Dr. Jamie does it. She brings it all to you right here. Did you do that so you weren't guilty? You're like, yeah, I divorce people every day, but I also marry them.
Well, it was funny. I was requested by a friend to officiate a wedding, so I went online, got ordained, and I've done a couple now. So
I love it. Well, if I renew my vows, I might be calling him. That would be great to have him as my minister. Okay, all right. My husband's saying, yes, let's do it. You're hired.
Here we go.
See? Okay, all right. Then the next thing that we do is I share a quote on the board, and you can tell us whether or not you agree or disagree with it and why. Facebook and Big Chat. So you know I'm quote crazy. Sometimes there's 30 quotes and I have to narrow it down to one or two. But believe it or not, this morning when I was bumming through quotes to put up here, I could not find one about divorce that I liked. Some were just like nasty, like if you don't like her, leave, or if you don't like him, you know, whatever. And I didn't like them, and there wasn't anything like really super supportive of children. And I'm sure they're out there, and if I would have spent another hour, I could have found something. But I didn't. So I created a quote, and I come from, so for those of you, and I told you when we get to 1,000 viewers on Facebook alone, I will retell my story. But for those of you that don't know, I came from a divorced family, so I can kind of like have that emotion behind it. So I wanted to read you a quote that I came up with, and then we'll see whether or not Damian finds part of it true, all of it true, none of it true. You better find it all true. Thank you. Just kidding. Okay, so it says, don't play telephone with your children. Tell mom this, tell dad that. You are not paying them to be your attorney, you are damaging them. Do you agree or disagree?
I 100% agree.
Yes, and I paid him to say that.
And I will say every judge I've ever been in front of will also agree with you as well.
Okay.
You should never use your kids as messengers. You have kids, they pick up on everything.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they'll pick up on your tone, and you know, you should never tell your kids, well, your dad didn't pay me child support, things like that. It's incredibly damaging. I'm not a psychologist, but all the psychologists say this.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you and your spouse and ex-spouse, you always should have a unified front, whatever you do with these kids.
Yeah.
You know, if you want them to grow up and be functioning members of society, leave them out of your drama.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they're kids. You know, your issue should be between your ex and yourself, not your kids.
Yes.
You know, you want them to grow up and be great kids. So
mm-hmm.
just stop. Don't do that. Never do that.
Yeah, I love it. And, you know, I love the words that he used, unified front. Parents, even if you're not divorced, even if you're happily, happily married, it is important when your child asks you for something or wants to do something that you and your spouse have a unified front. because otherwise we know, oh, I always go to dad for that. I always go to mom for that. And that creates tension between the parents. So very important that parents, when a child asks you for something, did you ask dad? Did you ask mom? Okay, let me ask dad and then I'll give you the answer. Always remain a unified front, or they have the ability to conquer and divide. Even if your children love you, they will conquer and divide, because ultimately a child wants what he wants. He wants the cookie before dinner. That's the end of the world. That's the most important thing. So they will conquer and divide. So unified front, whether you're divorced or not. Okay, excellent. Thank you.
Well, and you know, you really should be communicating about everything. Mm-hmm. And don't use your children to communicate about, you know, extracurricular activities, schoolwork, things like that. I mean, you know, you might hate each other, but you have this kid in common, and that's not going away for a long time. Even after the kid turns 18, we all know this, you know, you are going to be raising this child forever. So communicate with each other, get over your issues, and focus on raising this child. Yeah. That's the most important thing, without a doubt.
Yeah, and it's not easy. It's not easy, especially when you have, if someone did something to hurt you that you love so much, you have such that hatred and that anger inside. And we'll talk about co-parenting tips and, you know, even tips for maintaining mental health. Damien and I are going to do a segment after the show today on that, and you can watch that YouTube at a later time. But it is hard when you're running with that adrenaline and that anger to not throw whoever's in your way in the middle. And of course, it's always the kid in the line of fire, because they're there with you all the time. But you really got to find ways to retreat and change course before throwing them in the middle. Okay, so tell us a little bit about you personally and professionally. You have the McKinney Law Group. Tell us about all of it.
So I've been a family law attorney for over 10 years now, 10 long years.
Okay.
I went to Florida State, a big Florida State fan, and I came here to Stetson to go to law school, fell in love with Tampa, and I haven't left since.
Nice.
Been practicing family law for 10 years. I love our town. I think we have, you know, great things to do here. I'm never bored. We do have the best airport in town. I do like to travel, and I love what I do.
Nice.
I mean, weirdly, I do. I love what I do.
I love it. I love it. We're going to talk. Do you have any dogs?
I do have a dog. I have a 15-year-old lab who's still hanging on.
Nice. Because I can't wait. We're going to ask him a question later on the show. You have to wait. If you divorce, who gets custody of the dog if you both love the dog? So stay tuned for those juicy questions at the end. Okay. All right. So we are going to just jump right into some of the questions. So for all the viewers, what is a family law attorney? What is your role? What do you do?
So my main role is helping families get through family law litigation, whether it is divorce, a paternity case, custody, child support, if you want to come back and modify, you know, your divorce decree, things like that. You hire me, I help you navigate through this often very confusing and very challenging litigation system. So I'm your advocate, I'm your zealous advocate, and I represent you throughout that process through court, mediation, depositions, things like that. And ultimately, really the goal is to help you get through this very, very difficult time of your life and get a document that both parties hopefully agree upon, and help you move on through this and then really focus on closure and focus on helping you co-parent and, you know, both parents raising this child to be, you know, a great functioning member of society.
Excellent. Yeah, that is it, if they both agree. I'm sure we're going to talk about length that it takes for the divorce process. I'm sure there are things like not agreeing that hold it up. You know, before we get into talking all about divorce and what it entails and co-parenting, on the other side of it, the business side, the mental health side for the person running the business, can you tell us a little bit about how you handle dealing with negativity and then walking away to deal with your own life?
Sure. Like I said, I love what I do, but man, it's hard.
It's hard.
You know, because every person I'm dealing with is in the throes of this incredibly emotional time of their life. I mean, they equate it to, you know, death or something very, very tragic.
It's a loss.
Yeah, without a doubt, it's a loss. So, I mean, people are calling me up and they're upset, you know, people are crying. And admittedly, so they should be, of course. So I tend to compartmentalize, you know, work is work. My personal life is my personal life. And the most important thing is you have to make time for you. You know, I believe in traveling. I believe in, like, taking care of myself, working out, things of that nature. And, you know, when I'm on vacation, phone gets turned off. You know, work email gets turned off. And luckily I have this amazing support staff in my office that anytime a client has an issue, no matter what, there's someone they can talk to, sure. But for me, you gotta unplug. I mean, you really do. And because with these smartphones, you know, my whole office is right there on my phone. So anytime a client wants to get a hold of me, they're texting me, they're emailing me, something like that.
Yeah.
You know, and sometimes it never ends. You know, so when I'm at home, oftentimes in the evening, turn it off, open a book, you know, watch some Netflix, something like that. But you really have to let it go and focus on you, because if you don't, then, I mean, you're internalizing these people's problems all day, every day, from the minute you wake up to the minute you go to bed. Mm-hmm. And it can be taxing, it really can. But it's all about balance. It has to be about balance. And I will say, I think I'm pretty good at that.
Good.
You know, there's some attorneys that aren't, and I've had attorneys that had breakdowns.
Yes.
You know, dealing with this kind of stuff, just because it can really be taxing. And, mm-hmm. you know, ultimately I'm in charge, you know, of how these people's money and family get divided, and you know, it can be very difficult.
Mm-hmm.
So balance, most important thing, and you know, you got to focus on you at the end of the day.
Mm-hmm. I can share that with him. So when I first got out of school and I started my practice and everything was up and running, I worked in a facility similar to what you would know as Department of Children and Families, even though it wasn't that. And then I opened my practice and was dealing with like schizophrenia and bipolar and severe depression. And while it was hard for me, let me just say that, it was hard dealing with such extreme diagnoses, such extreme negativity and sadness. And it's not that it's a bad thing. It's just that you're dealing with it all day, every day. And it wasn't easy for me. And I wasn't good at balance at the time and compartmentalizing. And so for those of you that are out there that are dealing with these types of things, you've got to identify ways to find excitement or positivity in other areas of your life, or compartmentalize. Don't forget to eat healthy. Don't forget to exercise. Don't be making crazy impulsive decisions. Take a step back. Shut your phone off if you're in, you know, you're I'm doing something for your bucket list. Shut your darn phone off and go enjoy it for a minute. Then when you go back to work, you can give even more. So I love that.
And you know, it really is so important for my clients and people that are going through the divorce to do the same thing, because like we said, man, it's emotional. And you know, I see them come to me and they're just so ate up with the emotional part of it,
mm-hmm.
that sometimes they can't see straight. Sometimes you can't see the forest for the trees,
yes.
because, man, you want vengeance and you want justice,
yes.
and you want to screw that person.
Yes,
but
it's true. It's so true. It's funny, but it's true.
And at the end of the day, that can really blind your decision-making ability, because when we go to, say, mediation to try to resolve your case, I want you on, you know, your best game. I want you to be able to make cognizant, right decisions that are good for you, your finances, your children. And I don't want you to make these decisions off the cuff based on emotions, because you make the wrong decisions often if that's the case.
Mm-hmm.
And really, if you don't step back from it, you know, take some time for yourself and get in the right mental state,
mm-hmm.
you know, it could cost you a lot of money.
Yeah.
You know, because you're paying me to fight. I will fight for you, and I love it. It's my favorite thing that I do in my job. But there's a cost that comes along with that. And at the end of the day, you know, once this is all said and done, is it worth it to spend thousands of dollars based on vengeance?
Yes.
You know, and the principle of things, and you know, it's not. I'll tell you that it's not. But sometimes you can't see that.
You're
you know?
So blinded with that. Anger is such a strong emotion.
Right. It is. It isn't. Hey, I've gone through it. I've been angry before, and it you cannot make the right decisions for you and your family if you're ate up with that.
Mm-hmm.
And so we tend to help our clients. Here's a therapist you can go see. You know, why don't you go get a gym membership? Why don't you go do this and that, you know, to help you get to this place where you can effectively make the right decisions for you and your family that at the end of the day, you're not going to regret.
Mm-hmm. And you know, in aside from anger too, I've had clients that there's guilt. So let's say anger doesn't even exist within them. They're guilty. They feel like they hurt their children. They're guilty. They feel like they hurt maybe a religious reason or their extended family by getting a divorce. And so then for us to go in and say, go do something for yourself now. Go exercise. Go do a little shopping. Go, I don't know, go do whatever. They might even feel more guilt. Now I'm going to take time for myself. But that is part of the healing process, is taking a step back to clear your mind, get your goals right, and move forward. So sometimes you might have to be a little, if you call it selfish in the process to get clear-minded and do what's right for your family.
Well, yeah, and there could also be, you know, depression that comes along with this. It's sad.
It is.
You know, even for me, it's sad. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you just got to take care of yourself, because at the end of the day, your kids need you.
Yeah.
You know, they need you to make the right decisions. They need you to be there for them. Mm-hmm. You know, so.
I love it. Excellent. Okay, all right. So, I think I could just ramble about this all day. Okay, so I need a stick course, Davey. Okay, I bet that divorce can get ugly at times. How do you help your clients during the process? So it sounds like you give them resources to therapists and stuff, but what else do you do?
Well, it's all about expectation management. You have to, you know, manage your clients' expectations, because let's face it, in today's world, everyone knows someone that's been through this process. So, you know, your neighbor might have gone through this divorce and, oh, they got X amount of dollars for child support. I expect that too, but your case is 100% different than your,
yes.
You know, or the laws 10 years ago might be very different than they are today, because with our legislature here in Florida, the family laws change a lot, you know, and it's important to have a lawyer that's up on that. But you need to have your expectations managed, because yes, you know, you are going to court,
mm-hmm.
you know, and hopefully you don't. But if you have to go to court, you know, it's not going to be Judge Judy. Divorce court is what we call
it. Like when I was talking, flipping houses, it's not HGTV and heels. Okay, so we're not going to Judge Judy.
Right, everyone wants justice. They want justice. Yes. However, a lot of people don't realize that divorce court is what we call a court of equity.
Okay.
So at the end of the day, this judge wants both parties to walk out with something that's equitable. And sadly, that usually means both parties are pissed off at the end of it.
Okay.
You know, if it's fair, no one's happy.
No one's happy.
No.
I'm right. Yeah, especially since he or she did me dirty. She doesn't deserve anything.
Right. So a lot of my job is helping these people manage the expectations of what's going to happen.
Okay.
You know, and your case is not like your neighbor's. Trust me, it's not.
Mm-hmm.
Or your parents or your sisters or whatever. Each case is different, and you know, the judges make these decisions on a case-by-case basis, and that's what they're supposed to do, because they're supposed to look at what's in the best interest of your children, of your finances, etc. So when they do that, each case is brand new, you know, and they take all the evidence and make that decision based on what's specific to you and your family. So, like I said, your family's different than your neighbors. So don't expect that, you know, you're going to get everything that they did.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a common thing, and that's a lot of my job is helping them deal with that expectations. But other than that, yeah, resources are very important. Let people help you get through this.
Okay.
You know, because sometimes you can't do it on your own.
I think managing the expectations is huge. That's an excellent point. Putting people into perspective.
And you know, I will say, if I tell you something, listen to me. I know what I'm doing. I've been doing this for over 10 years now, exclusively family law.
Breaking news.
Yeah. You know, you're paying me a lot of money. You might as well listen to my advice.
Yeah.
And that, sometimes that's hard, because it goes back to that, you know, emotional blindness,
yes.
of it all. But, you know, I'm removed from the situation enough that I can tell you, okay, I know this judge. I'm in front of this judge every week. I know what they're typically going to do in these type of situations. So if I say, you know, the likelihood of this happening, you know, listen to me.
Right. Don't spend $3,000 when I know that no matter what he's going to say no.
Right. Or $30,000 or $50,000.
Yeah. Right.
It's just not worth it. So, and you know, not even me, all your other attorneys. There's so many great family law attorneys here in
mm-hmm.
town. And, you know, if they're telling you something, you got to listen, because otherwise, what are you using me for? What are you paying me for?
Right. Okay. All right. Very good. So when it comes to divorce then, so if a couple comes to you wanting divorce, is there like, do they need to go through a separation process? Do you recommend separation first? What's going on with separation and divorce?
So one thing I do want to explain is that I don't represent couples.
Okay.
Yeah. I would never meet with two people together at the same time.
Okay.
That's definitely a conflict of interest.
Okay.
I would represent one party, and one party only. Mm-hmm. And that is a common misconception a lot, because people tend to think, oh, we worked it out, we're both going to go to this one lawyer, and we're going to get it signed. But no, my job is to represent one person and one person only. I can help you through that process, but I don't represent the couple.
Okay.
Separation is a question that I get a lot. There is no such thing as a legal separation in Florida. People, I probably get that question once a day. In other states there are. Say, for example, I believe like North Carolina, they require that you be legally separated for, I believe, at least 6 months before they'll sign a divorce.
Wow.
And I know New York had that for a while. I think they might have gotten rid of that.
You
know,
your personal opinion real quick. Do you agree with that?
No.
No.
No. And you know, you talked about Florida laws being weird, but Florida is pretty progressive in their divorce laws, and they're usually on the cutting edge of, you know, what's happening typically.
Interesting.
The separation thing, I think, is pretty antiquated.
Okay.
And it kind of goes along with this no-fault divorce. You know, certain states, and there's hardly any left in the nation now, will only allow you to divorce for certain reasons, you know, adultery, things like that. Florida's not like that. You're able to get divorced if one party asks for divorce. And that's pretty progressive. Most states in the nation now have that. But in Florida, if you and your spouse have an agreement, you could be divorced in 2 weeks, technically, after you sign it. So that's very different than states that require the separation. I don't really know why they do that. I mean, I think it's old, antiquated. The judges here will ask, can I do anything to help you get back together? Can I send you to counseling or whatever? But in my experience, I've literally had no one ever say yes to that. You know, because that, when you've spent thousands of dollars and you've gone through this whole process, the chance of reconciliation is usually pretty slim. You know, most people come to me when they're at that point that they're ready to break up. And, you know, most people are, you know, adult about it, and they tried the counseling, you know. But we do recommend it. We do recommend it mainly for, you know, your own mental health to go see a counselor. But
I'm curious to know what your views are. Do you think like 6 months waiting in separation and then getting divorced? I'm actually on the fence about it, Damien.
Because
I think a part of me says when you get to the point of divorce, you've already been checked out. So yeah, you say divorce, I say divorce, we're ready, we're done. We've already been thinking about this 6 months, we've been thinking about it for 2 years, we're done. But then on the other side of it, I almost feel like live alone for a while, live different lives. Do you miss each other? So I don't know if that's maybe I'm running with my heart there or what, I don't know. But I'm kind of on the fence about
it. Well, and you know, that's a smart thing to do too, because I have had clients reconcile. It's very rare, you know, like I said. But I have had clients go through this process and realize, hey, this is not what we want. You know, and they do get back together. It's I would probably say 1% of my cases do that, you know. But, I mean, I'm all for it, you know. I'm married. My parents are still married. My grandparents, both sides, are still married. I mean, I believe in marriage, you know.
Yeah.
But if it's time, it's time.
It's time, it's time. Okay. All right, excellent. So kind of on the separation side of things, but I'm just the cohabitating issue. If I heard, and this is rumor has it, so I'm going to get clarification. If you like cohabitate with someone for like 7 years, I don't know where this came from, if I'm creating this, if I trumped it, then it's like a spouse. So you have to divide stuff. And is any of that true about cohabitating?
In the state of Florida, that's absolutely not true.
Okay.
So I don't know if you know this or not, but divorce laws are on a state by state basis.
Okay.
So the laws here in Florida, oftentimes they're very different than the laws, say, in Texas or New York or whatever.
Okay.
What you're referring to is called common law marriage.
Okay.
In states, I've looked this up, and I know that Texas does have something called a common law marriage.
Okay.
And so if you do live together for a certain period of time, it's more than just living together, by the way, because I've researched this law for a case that I had a while back. You have to hold yourself out as being a married couple. So you got to tell people you're married. You know what I mean? You got to have your name on joint bank accounts, a name on the house, things like that. So it's not just living together. It's not just you and I were roommates for 7 years, then we have to split everything.
Okay.
It's a lot more than that. And it really is, you know, are you holding yourself out in the community to be married even though you haven't signed that paper? Then, yes, that's a common law marriage. I believe it's 7 years.
Okay.
Don't quote me on that because it's not a law here in Florida. But if you met all those things, then you know, it treats it as an actual marriage, and you know, you do divide your property, things like that, in that state. But In Florida, not a thing.
Not a thing. Mm-hmm. Okay, all right. So let's say the couple comes to you. They decide divorce is for us. And the couple doesn't come to you. One comes to you. Correction. And so they decide we're moving forward with the divorce. Can you kind of walk people through like the process of exactly how this happens now?
Sure. And please let me not forget too technical and legal terms.
People in the background. They'll just throw a rock at him.
Yeah.
You know what? Here's what I'll do. Code word will be like, I'll just put the hat on. Slow and steady.
Time for a shot.
Time for a shot. Okay, is this getting long?
So you come to me, ready to divorce, retain me. We draft up the divorce papers. Everyone's heard that term. They know what that is. Mm-hmm. It essentially is a document that creates the lawsuit. It gets filed with the clerk down in Tampa, if you're in Tampa. And then we have a process server take that document to your ex and bang on the door, you've been served. It's a very scary process for some people, and there are ways to avoid that, and that we'll get into that.
Okay.
But once you're served, then you have 20 days to file a response. Mm-hmm. And your response is probably going to mirror what they said, you know, but that opens up the case. The case is ready to proceed. From there, every case goes to mediation.
Okay.
Mediation is an excellent process. Most of my cases do settle at mediation. Mm-hmm. I encourage everyone to settle their case at mediation, you know, because at that point, you're in control of your life, your children, your finances. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, if you don't reach an agreement at mediation, then you're at the mercy of a judge. And
remember that. Mm-hmm. Remember that. You have control in mediation. Do not let your anger escalate it to that next level where you lose control.
Right, because if you lose control and you have a judge make a decision, I absolutely cannot guarantee what this judge is going to do. And, you know, the judges are there to follow the law, but every single one of them has their own personal bias. And when it comes to family law, judges have so much discretion to make decisions. Mm-hmm. You know, when it comes to custody, judges can do whatever they want. After they hear evidence, they can do what they think is in your child's best interest. And often what they think is in your child's best interest is absolutely not what you think is in your child's best interest. Mm-hmm. So I often, you know, counsel clients to avoid going in front of a judge unless your ex is just being 100% unreasonable and, you know, you have to.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but mediation is a wonderful process. I highly recommend it, and you know, at the end of the day, you're going to be happier. You're not going to be completely happy. Like we said, you know, if it's a fair agreement, no one's really happy, mm-hmm. but you're going to be happy knowing that, one, you've made this decision with your ex-spouse regarding, you know, what's in the best interest for your children and your family, and you have closure, you mm-hmm. know, because, like I said, if you don't go to mediation, then it's litigation.
And that's a long process. That could be a long process.
A long and expensive mm-hmm. process. Mm-hmm. And when it comes to litigation, you know, this is what you see on TV. You're sitting on the stand. I'm asking you questions to the judge. The judge asks you questions. The other side is jumping up, objection, objection, things like that. The rules of evidence apply. So, mm-hmm. you know, the things that you might want the judge to know, you might not be able to tell the judge because there's all these rules that are established for presenting evidence. And you get to be cross-examined by the other attorney. Mm-hmm. You know, you don't know what they're going to ask. You have no idea. Mm-hmm. And it's public record. So all of your life, your children, your finances, everything is out in the open. Anyone can go get that transcript, take a look at it. So it's usually something that I counsel clients to avoid is going to the court process. But it happens. And you know what? If the other side is being unreasonable, then, yeah, I'll tell you, we have to go do this because otherwise what they're offering is something outside of the realm of what a judge would do.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So don't get married. Tip number one. And then if you do get married, you never want to go past mediation. Stop. That's the end zone. Okay. All right. So this process sounds like it can be super intense. What is like the average, and not necessarily your fees, but what is the average range of like an easy divorce versus a common tough divorce?
As far as cost?
Yeah.
So, yeah, obviously costs vary drastically between attorneys.
Yes.
Most of us do bill by the hour. And it's 100% going to depend on how amicable you are and how amicable your spouse or ex-spouse is.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, average $5,000 up to $30,000 if you go to trial. Sometimes $50,000 if you're crazy litigious, it could be in the hundreds of thousands.
Mm-hmm.
That's rare.
Yeah.
But, you know, it and why waste all that when mm-hmm. you and your spouse can come to the table, reach an agreement, and move on. You have closure that mm-hmm. you know that you had a process in. Because again, if you go in front of that judge, it's you're up to the mercy of the court. Mm-hmm. You know,
it would not going through a divorce would not be easy for me. So I can't speak to that yet. But I will say that not yet. Did I just say yet? I can't speak to that yet. No, never. My husband did that. Never. But. So I can't totally speak to that, but what I will say is some of you out there might be going through this process and you're fighting for your kids. Two things. One, make sure under it all you're not fighting for your ego. And then number two, make sure that you sometimes stop fighting and not getting the last word is fighting for your kids. Because then that extra $20,000 you would spend in litigation, is that right?
Yeah.
Litigation? Put that toward their college. Put that toward their car. Put that toward a wedding. Put that toward their first house. Put that toward just survival of your own home so that you can take care of them. And so sometimes not getting the last word and not fighting is the true fight for your child.
Right. And at the end of the day, I want my clients to go through this process and be happy with me. Mm-hmm. I can't guarantee that if we go in front of a judge, you're going to be happy. You know, so I encourage my clients to come to an agreement that you might not like, but at the end of the day, it's over, and you know, you have something to follow when it comes to co-parenting your kids, because a judge could have a bad day, you know, and I could present every single piece of law that says, well, this is what you should do, and sometimes the judge is like, well, I'm not going to do that. Mm-hmm. I'm going to do something else. And what are you left with? You're left with an order that you absolutely do not like. You're left hating me, yeah. even though I did everything that I can, and then you're left with the only option is to appeal that case. Mm-hmm. And that
money.
Minimum $10,000, sure, to appeal a case. So,
oh my God, don't do it!
And it could take a year to, mm-hmm. to even get something, and then the appellate court could just say, okay, the judge did this wrong, send everything back and redo it. So you're another year, you know, trying to get this thing corrected. So don't do it, just settle.
Okay, so just settle. Put your ego to the side. Put your anger to the side. Anger can cost you some serious money. Now the moment we've all been waiting for. Okay, our dogs. So let's say Damien and I are married. We're so happy. We bought this dog. We've raised him for 8 years. He is our baby. Now we're ending it, and I want the damn dog. And he says, oh, no, 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 no. I want the damn dog. Who gets the dog?
So that's an interesting question, and there has begun a very small sea change across the nation with these laws. Currently, right now, every state but Alaska says your dog is personal property. Your dog is nothing more than Paws and Pants.
Okay. So, okay, except for Alaska, okay.
Right, so Alaska it very recently enacted a law that allows people to have custody of dogs. Now, that being said,
holidays and weekends. I get Christmas 2018.
Right. And you know, that being said, the people that I deal with, if you go to mediation, you have control of that. Mm-hmm. Because a judge is bound by the law, mm-hmm. and they have to follow what the legislator puts out, what the case law says. However, you and your spouse can enter into any kind of agreement that you want. Okay. You can do whatever you want with your dog. And I've negotiated those agreements and drafted those agreements where there is a custody schedule.
Okay.
You know, 1 week with mom, 1 week with dad. And
okay.
It's enforceable and,
okay.
you know, it's completely allowed.
Okay.
But when it comes to the law, the only state is Alaska. And Alaska says you can have custody, but otherwise, the judge is dividing it like they're dividing a couch.
Okay. Yeah. All right. There you go. Dog equals couch in Florida, but you can put it in the terms of agreement.
Correct.
That are held. Okay. All right. So we brought up adultery early on, and I know some people have this question. So on the Dr. Jamie Show, we like to ask questions people think, but they don't say. So adultery, in any respect, does that hold up in court in any capacity?
The answer is it depends.
Okay.
It's always the answer usually in the court of law. Man, adultery sucks. And I have so many clients that come to me and they said, oh, my spouse cheated. And they want that vengeance. They want to get into court and they want me to grill their spouse about all of this. Sadly, in general, the judge just doesn't care.
Yeah.
You know, the only time a judge would ever care is if your spouse is spending significant amounts of your marital money on what we call a paramour, the girlfriend or the boyfriend.
Okay.
You know, if they're taking them on lavish vacation to France, buying jewelry, buying them a boat, things like that, That is waste. That's depletion of your assets. And you can get that back, sure. But, you know, if your child, your spouse cheats on you, and, you know, you want alimony, oftentimes the court's going to order it, even though, you know, or you cheated. Mm-hmm. It just doesn't matter. And I've had judges shoot me down. Nope, I don't want to hear about that. Yep. I don't want to hear about that all the time.
I can understand how that would induce rage in some people. So, for example, if my husband cheated on me and now he wants sole custody of the kids. Rage!
Right, yeah.
Rage! Are you kidding me?
Or, you know, my wife cheated on me and now she wants me to pay her permanent alimony.
Oh my God!
Yeah.
Oh my God! And so just thinking about it induces that rage. And so I can understand for those of you going through it how hard it would be to change course and to be like, okay, I'm going to be civil now. When you were done dirty and they want your kids and they want you to pay alimony. Oh my goodness.
Well, and think about it. How in the world are you going to prove that?
Right.
You know, because no one's going to admit to it.
Yep.
Right?
Yep.
You know, so it's very hard to prove as well. So,
it's
something that judges don't really care about.
Okay. All right. That's rough. All right. So we have about 9 minutes left. Let me see what else I got on here that I want to ask you. My joke on here that I didn't say when we were talking about money, as I was going to say, is it really cheaper to keep her? Ha, 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 ha.
I had a reserve comment on that.
alimony and child support, real quick, for those people out there, how do they calculate child support? How do they calculate alimony?
There are two very different things.
Okay.
Child support is a calculation, a guideline that's set forth by the Florida legislature in the statute.
Okay.
So they take your income, your spouse's income, combine them together, you get some deductions, health insurance goes in, daycare goes in. At the end of the day, numbers are crunched and there's a number given to you. All the judges have a program they use, they do all this, and that's the number, that is what it is.
Okay.
Deviating from that number is very difficult and often doesn't happen. One factor that really plays into this is your time sharing schedule. So if you have 50-50, then your child support is going to be very low or often not at all.
Wow.
Yeah, but if you're the parent that has the child almost every single day, then the other parent is going to pay the normal guideline child support.
Mm-hmm.
So the more time you have, the less you pay, essentially.
Okay.
It's very complicated. The statute is like 10 pages long.
Okay.
You know how to
calculate
this? Yeah, right?
Right.
alimony, 100% different.
Okay.
So alimony is very subjective. The judges have...
Can you explain what alimony is just in a sentence or two to people out there?
Sure. It's spousal support.
Okay.
So say, for example, and this is the very traditional role, oftentimes we know today is not traditional. It could vary wildly. But you and I are married. We were married for 25 years. You didn't work. You stayed home with the kids. You put your career off this whole 25 years. Now we're getting divorced, and what the hell are you going to do?
Okay.
Right? You have no career. You have no job skills, nothing like that. So these laws are designed to protect someone like you.
Okay.
And essentially, at 25 years, they would order me to pay you permanent alimony so that you maintain what's called the standard of living that we had during our marriage.
Okay.
And the judges have a lot of subjectivity to do that. It's based on really, what do you need? You know, you're leaving now, you're living in your own home. How much do you need to survive and pay your bills and live comfortably?
Mm-hmm.
And then the judge looks at, well, how much can I pay? You know, how much do I have the ability to pay you after all my expenses are paid?
Okay.
So sadly, often it's not enough for you to live.
Yes.
You know, and we see cases like this where, you know, they have to go and get a job, you know, after not working for 20 years. And I'm sure you can realize that job is not going to be a very high-paying job in the beginning.
Can you get alimony if, so let's say we both were working, I'm a life coach, you're an attorney, now we divorce, can I get alimony or vice versa, or no, because we were working?
Well, so it still goes to what is your need, because your income will come into play there.
Oh, I see.
So at the end of the day, you're literally going to fill out a form that says my rent is X amount, my electricity is X amount, my cell phone, my cable, my food, all that. It's going to say what you need to live on a monthly basis. And then we take your income, take some deductions out of your taxes, and here's your net income. Does that net income meet those needs?
Okay,
if it does, then you don't need alimony because you can support yourself.
Okay, excellent. All right. right, so there are your tips on child support and alimony. Let me see if I can give him one more question, and then we are going to wrap it up with Damian McKinney. Please follow him. He has a wealth of knowledge. If you have any questions, go to themckinneylawgroup.com, and we're going to find out exactly where you can follow him, his blog, in just minutes, so just hold tight. All right, let me see.
Let's talk about co-parenting tips.
Okay, yeah, co-parenting, I want to ask you about grandparents, too. So co-parenting.
Okay.
Either or.
Yeah, so co-parenting can be hard. It can be very hard after you're separated. But, you know, the most important thing is that you listen. Listen, 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 listen. You know, and the most second most important thing is you don't involve your kids in this process. Mm-hmm. You know, like we said, unified front. You know, your parents that are raising this one child are two or three or four. Mm-hmm. And you want this child to be as healthy as possible. So put your issues aside. Mm-hmm. Focus on the child. It's all about the child. You know, you go to a therapist, get through your issues with the divorce, let it go, and then focus on this child. Don't use them as messengers, things like that.
And if you don't, and I know sometimes, especially if you have that hate or anger inside of you, you know, separated from your spouse even after years, your kids are still growing up. Maybe they were divorced at 9, now they're teenagers. Now they want to go to do summer camp XYZ. Like, you still have to communicate. I think that's the key.
Right.
Is get over it and communicate, even if it's through email, right? I mean, that's great to track it.
Hey, I prefer that as a lawyer. There's a paper
that helps the man out. Okay, it helps the man out.
Yeah, you got to communicate. Your kids have school pictures. Mm-hmm. Let mom know. You know, mm-hmm. Your kid has a test coming up. You know, kids has homework. Communicate. Mm-hmm. You know, because the whole goal for both of you is to make sure this kid does great in school. You know, is a functioning member of society, doesn't have behavioral problems, doesn't get in trouble. You know, mm-hmm. And you have to listen, but you also have to communicate. And that's something, you know, let the other side have a say, too. Yeah. You know, the kids need braces. Well, call mom up and say, hey, the kid needs braces. Here's how much it is. Do you think we could do this? Mm-hmm. You know, don't just go to the dentist and put these braces on your kid's teeth without letting the other parent know.
Yes, yes. My son just had braces. And just a quick story. He was supposed to go in with my husband. I've been to every dental visit. I've been to every doctor's visit. He goes in with my husband. I said, oh, he needs a quick, I think something was loose. Can they go glue it back on? Or I don't know, it was a retainer or something. He didn't have braces yet. And my husband called me and he's like, oh yeah, they decided they're going to throw braces on Wesley. Like, oh, what? And I'm sitting at home, I'm like, oh, I'm not there for this. So it does matter. Braces do matter. Don't get braces without the other spouse there. Okay, and my last question, I know we're coming up on time, so much information, but I knew there was one more I wanted to ask you. It's another rumor question. I heard that grandparents have, like, rights, but they have rights, but, like, if, let's say, I just decided today, I don't want my two boys to see my mom or Wes's mom again. No reason. I just don't want it to happen. They can sue me for, like, custody. Not custody, but, like, rights to see them. Is that true?
That is absolutely not true.
Okay. No. Don't worry, Mom. And, Mom, you can see them. In fact, I want you to see them. In fact, we want a date tonight. So if you want to see them, come on back.
Nope. Grandparents have zero rights in Florida. When it comes to that, yeah. Okay. Now there's obviously technicalities, et cetera. You know, if you know the parents want to give temporary custody to the grandparents, that happens, sure. But when it comes to visitation, unfortunately, that does not happen in Florida.
Okay.
Now there was a recent weird case that another state, say like Colorado, does have that. And there was an order that said, okay, grandma gets visitation, but everyone moved to Florida. Then this court has to enforce that out-of-state order because there's something called full faith and credit, and that gets even more technical.
Okay.
But, you know, if you get an order from another state, come to Florida, Florida will enforce that order. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
But in general, Florida law, there is no grandparents' rights.
Okay. All right. Sorry, grandparents, but we love you. We couldn't do it without you. We want you to babysit our kids every day of the week. Please help us out. Okay. So, Tanya, thank you for being here
with us.
Absolutely. Thank you. Okay. So, if people want to follow you, want to know more information about you, I know you have a killer blog. Where can we follow you, read about it, et cetera?
Well, themckinneylawgroup.com is going to be the flagship website, the place to start.
Okay.
We're all over social media, Instagram, Twitter, LinkedIn, Google+, Facebook, all those things.
We just type in the McKinney Law Group and we can find you on all those?
Very easy to find, yes.
Excellent, excellent. Very good. Okay, and before we leave, Damian, can you give the viewers one last piece of advice in this area? My advice would be don't go to litigation. Stop at mediation. What would your advice be?
The most important thing that you have to do is listen. And I'm not saying agree with the other side, but you're in mediation, you have to listen to their viewpoint. You have to listen to what they're saying and where they're coming from. She wants this time sharing schedule, we'll listen to it. I'm not saying agree, but to help you get to where you need to be, you have to be able to listen and understand, you know, why they want this. And if I was in the other room, I would tell the other side that too. So listen is the most important thing, and it's the most common thing that people don't do.
Yes, in every area of life. I love that advice. Listen, if it's one thing that you do, divorce completely aside, take this week and this weekend and into next week to just stop and listen. Stop the rambling and just listen to what people have to say. You find out so much information when you listen. Thank you so much, VidChat and Facebook, for joining the Dr. Jamie Show on this Cinco de Mayo, this fifth day of May. Cinco de Mayo. I have to wear the hat for you. I hope you enjoyed my memes. Thank you for joining us. Next week, we have Akesh Patel, the founder of Elevate, and four moms. Go to the Superwoman. Go to the Superwoman page. Go to Amazon.com. Type in the Superwoman's Guide to Super Fulfillment and grab a copy of the book. We love you. Happy Cinco de Mayo.